My name's Andy Cutchins. I'm here with Georgetown University, and it's a co-chair with my friend and colleague Angela of the conference, and delighted to be chairing the final panel today. There are, as everybody knows, some eternal questions in Russia. You know, one is kto vinovat, who's guilty. To some extent, we addressed that a bit in the morning and earlier, although it was quite balanced, I think, in the way it was done. And now is really the harder part, что делать? What's to do? And we try to look ahead and see how we might extricate ourselves from this really, truly abysmal state of affairs in the bilateral relationship. It's not only abysmal, but it's actually extremely dangerous. The Bulletin of Atomic Scientists and their famous doomsday clock is now at 2.5 minutes to midnight. The last, which is their kind of measurement of how close we are to Armageddon, basically. The last time it was at 2.5 minutes to midnight was in 1953, the year that Uncle Joe died. In the fall, when I was working on a report on U.S.-Russia relations, it was at 3 minutes before midnight. And I interviewed 42 former U.S. and Russian policymakers, some in this room and others that have participated in the conference, about the relationship to try to get a sense of what's happened in 25 years. And one of the quotes that really stuck with me was from a former Secretary of Defense, Bill Perry, at Stanford. And he said, "Andy, we are sleepwalking on nukes." Sleepwalking on nukes. Of course, the reference to Christopher Clark's brilliant history of how Europe sleptwalked into World War I. And there's been some discussion earlier in the morning about the proximity of US, NATO, Russian military forces in the Middle East, of course in Europe, in the Baltics, also in East Asia. There's a lot of deconfliction to be done. But it's quite striking that we've reached this point where the decision to put it at 2.5 minutes before midnight, principally because of what's happened in the U.S.-Russia relationship. Okay, we have a really excellent set of panelists, and it's quite geographically diverse. We have Paula Dobryansky based in Boston, Andrei Kortunov based in Moscow, Stefan Meister based in Berlin, Arkady Ostrovsky based in London, and Paul Duquesnoy based in Beirut. So we're going to move in alphabetical order, as we have in the program. And so first, let me introduce, say a little bit more about Paula. Paula is a foreign policy expert and former diplomat, specializing in national security affairs. She's currently a senior fellow in the Future of Diplomacy project at Harvard University's Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs. And during her more than 25 years in government, she held Senate-confirmed high-level positions, including Under Secretary of State for Global Affairs for 8 years, 2001 to 2009, Director of European and Soviet Affairs at the White House National Security Council, Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs, and Deputy Head of the Delegation to the 1990 Copenhagen Conference on Security and Cooperation on Europe. So Paula, you bring a wealth of experience and insight and knowledge on this topic. What do you think we can do now?
All right. Well, first, Andy, let me commend you and Angela for holding this conference. I think it's very timely. And I think it's also crucial to have thought given to these questions. In my few minutes up front, I'm not going to answer that so specifically yet, but let me at least make four basic points that I think are relevant to addressing that question. The first is as you described earlier, it was described what's the state of the relationship. I think most would say that the relationship is at one of its lowest ebbs. Some would use the term that it's stalemated, some will say it's frozen, but it is at a very low point. I know that a number of issues were also mentioned, but let me take a moment, if I can, because I do think some of these are relevant also to the question of how do you go forward? Because some of these issues, there are some fundamental differences on. And, you know, how do you overcome that? Or do you? Can you? The first being is, I think, the issue of Russia's annexation of Crimea and also of the aggression in Ukraine is clearly an issue that impacts not only the United States, but also West and Western Europe. The fact that there are sanctions in place, and we're going to be hearing from our German colleague, but I was struck by the fact that very recently the German foreign minister, who I interacted with when I was in government, Sigmar Gabriel, just recently made a statement indicating the continuation of these sanctions because of a lack of reconciliation and a movement relative to Minsk. There's also the question in the same basket of the actions in Syria and the human tragedy that came forward. So one, I mentioned that as a backdrop. Secondly, another area that is a very fundamental area is just the outlook that from Washington and maybe the West and then from Moscow over what should be the framework, the international framework, or the term that's used, the liberal international order. It's fundamentally different. Here, there's strongly held views, I would say, certainly by the United States and I think by the West, in terms of the fact that this architecture has held together the global community in terms of peace, stability, and security. Some will argue that the values undergirding it must remain in place, but that with a changed global environment, should one look at reform? So here, as a second key point, I would just say, though, there's a really a fundamental difference of outlook over questions of values and over questions of these institutions and the role which they play. I would say, thirdly, I'm also have to put in the mix the concern forward, which is the concern just about what movements could be next from Moscow, from Russia. The Baltic states have been very outspoken, and you know that, but let me pick out the Nordic states. I've been very struck by the fact that many of the Nordic countries have come forward and have really expressed a range of political, economic, and military concerns of intent. And what does this mean for, again, a kind of peace and stability? Finally, I will say on this, just this first point, there's the backdrop, which we all know, which is the question of the engagement and involvement and interference in the electoral processes that are afoot, not only the United States, Europe. We're having investigations taking place on this about hacking. So the questions here, I would just say, is first starting with the premise that I think that those who may have different ways that they look at the relationship and different ways they think we should go forward, I would say that there is, I think, a general consensus that we are at a really low ebb in terms of the state of the relationship. And it's difficult to find a way forward if you don't have a common basis from which to spring from, if there are some fundamental differences that have to be taken into account. My second main point is, I think one thing that characterizes this period, strikingly so, at least that I could remember, and when I think back to times of the Cold War, I really don't remember this in particular, and that is the fact that we have a negative political domestic climate, both here and also in Russia. I'd say in both contexts. When you look at actually some polls, and there was a Gallup poll that basically said that 7 in 10 Americans told pollsters that they had an unfavorable view of Russia. By the way, there have also been polls taken there, and I think you will also find some of the same in terms of the outlook, at least as has been reported. I mention that because how does that factor in when you're, if you try to look and find common areas, and if your domestic constituencies also have certainly strongly held views? The third that I would say is the question of, all right, with this backdrop, does it mean that we should not try to find basically areas of common interest? My answer is, yes, we should. And I think there are a number of areas that have been mentioned and that have been focused on, and I will be glad to go a little bit more into that. But let me cite something that strikes me, and that is that there are a number of institutions who have put forth reports and actually are focused on this question in a very deep way. But the interesting thing is what they have in common is trying to find a way forward and engage, but they have a different framework for doing so. And let me just mention quickly the three. One is the Atlantic Council just put a report forward, and they came forward with a term of, well, we should follow a policy of constrainment. And they defined that new term, a constrainment, if you will, in saying that one should look at concerted efforts to constrain aggressive actions and continue with sanction policy, but at the same time adopt a policy of principled engagement. Then there's the Center for the National Interest, which also put forth the report. I believe you had a number of speakers who've also written pieces for that particular report earlier here today. And that's on looking at a new direction in U.S.-Russia relations. And it was interesting when you read that report and some of the ideas put forward, they're very focused on particular areas versus a broad approach. And then finally, again, these are only a few examples, there are others. The Elb Group just met. They were started in 2010. And it was interesting in hearing some of the reports back from that, that again, sort of very clearly defined areas that don't seem to be areas of compromise and that are non-starters, but that there are some areas that should be considered. So, in my short minutes up front, because we'll have a more robust discussion, I'll just say that I think for policy, kind of policy to succeed in this approach, I think that it really depends on this whole issue of whether there is area, whether there are, areas for compromise. Compromise actually in coming to the table and not just having the sake of discussion for the sake of discussion. And also, I will say that, and this is obviously just from the U.S. perspective, I think that there have been, there's been a view that certain kinds of conduct that has emanated from Russia, that it's difficult to move forward unless there's a change in that conduct. So, yes, there should be a way forward, and it's a question of how to find it.
Thanks very much, Paula. I'm not sure if I'm going to adopt the word constrainment to my my vocabulary. I will take the opportunity to mention the report that I wrote for the Center on Global Interests, which I use the words elevation and calibration. But you'll have to read the report to see what I meant about that, okay?
I apologize for not mentioning yours, but you did write, and I thought I would go outside of Georgetown a little bit.
And you were one of my interviewees, thank you. Our next speaker is an old friend, Andrei Kortunov, the Director General of the Russian International Affairs Council. Prior to being elected Director General, Dr. Kortunov was the Deputy Director of the Institute for USA and Canada Studies of the Russian Academy of Sciences in Moscow. He's also the founder and the first president of the Moscow Public Science Foundation. Remember that back in the 1990s. He graduated from MGIMO and completed his postgraduate studies also at the Institute for USA and Canada Studies, a place well known to us back from Soviet days. He's taught Russian foreign policy at a number of US institutions and written many, many articles, over 120, and really one of Russia's most thoughtful analysts and thinkers about international relations and international security. So, Andrei, welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Andy. And I'm grateful that I have an opportunity to be here and to participate in this event, which, frankly speaking, makes me a little bit more optimistic about the future of the relationship than I often feel outside of this building in this city. And the big question, of course, where the reality is it here or is it somewhere else within the Beltway. Since I'm the only person from Moscow on this panel, I would respectfully ask to grant me not 5 minutes, but 5.5 minutes. And since I'm not a native speaker.
Oh, we give you five to seven.
Okay, 5 to 7. First of all, since a couple of documents were mentioned here already about U.S.-Russian relations, I cannot resist temptation to mention the report that we've just released together with CSIS on opportunities in the relationship. And we tried to identify low-hanging fruits and came up with, I think, 8 or 9 really? Of them. Some of them are not really toxic. Some of them are. Some would require bilateral relations to be changed for the better. Some of them would require multilateral approach. But definitely, you know, there is, if there is a will, there is a way. I don't want to retail the report. You can find it on the CIS website. But let me try to be a little bit more theoretical. You inspired me talking about constraint and about terms. I would like to offer for your consideration an adjective hybrid. Now, it's fashionable these days to take a look at hybrid phenomena in this world, you know, hybrid political regime, or hybrid economic model, or hybrid war. And usually this adjective has a negative meaning. There is something bad in being hybrid. I would venture to say that probably the best that we can expect in the relationship is this hybrid relationship in the years to come. And this is not to say that by hybrid I mean a mixture of cooperation, confrontation. I think that would be too primitive an approach. But when I talk about hybrid, I mean that we have two overlapping agendas in the relationship. And each of these agendas has its own logic, its own constituency, its own stakeholders, and its own momentum. The old agenda is something that we essentially inherited from the 21st century. We simply failed, for a variety of reasons, we failed to clean the mess left in the end of the Cold War. And we instead tried to sweep this garbage under the carpet, and now this garbage is back again in front of our eyes. And when I think about what major items constitute this agenda, it is, of course, arms race and arms control. I think to the large extent it's non-proliferation, which I consider to be essentially a problem of the 20th century, at least state non-proliferation. I think that most of regional conflicts were inherited from the previous century. You go to Korea and divided nation, you go to Middle East, and the Israeli-Palestinian question is something that we, you know, inherited from mid-20th century. So it doesn't mean that this agenda is always divisive, negative. I think, you know, it also constitutes an important stimulus, an important incentive for cooperation, but we should consider it as something that we have to clean behind us and to move ahead. And there is a new agenda, the agenda of the 21st century. Sometimes we downplay this agenda or ignore this agenda, but I think it is nevertheless quite important. This agenda consists of emerging problems and emerging opportunities in the relationship. We can talk about issues like climate change or migration management. We can talk about international terrorism. We can talk about more general problems of the global governance, including reform of major international institutions, specifically the reform of the United Nations, which is really a burning problem for all of us. We can talk about food security. We can talk about Arctic. I think this is a new agenda, and this agenda involves entirely different groups of stakeholders on both sides. Again, I don't want to imply that this agenda is necessarily a positive one. I think that we can see clashes of interests about climate change or about food security between Russia and the United States, but these will be very different clashes of interests compared to what we have right now in Ukraine or even in Syria. So, in fact, I think we should try to balance the two agendas. Definitely, we should not lose the sight of the first one. It is important, and I agree with Paula that there are certain issues that will continue to poison the relationship unless we approach them. We cannot move ahead at any desirable speed if we do not approach Ukraine. It's evident that this is something that we have to approach. There are more general issues. You know, we have to deal with our narratives. We have to deal with our perceptions of the future, what is desirable, what is feasible, what is fair and what is not fair. And right now, probably for the United States, it's a little bit more complicated than for Russia because it is one of those rare cases when Russia turns out to be a little bit more predictable than this country. Usually it's the other way around, of course. At the same time, I think that it would be important, especially for us, as people who claim to be experts in the relationship, to keep in mind this emerging agenda, not to forget this emerging agenda, because if we are thinking about how to stabilize the relationship and hopefully how to change this relationship for the better, we will not be able to do that if we rely only on traditional stakeholders on both sides. This is what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andre. You know, you said you were in kind of an optimistic mood in this room, and I must say that if in the REAC CSIS report you're able to identify 8 or 9 pieces of low-hanging fruit on the agenda in U.S.-Russian relations.
Well, not that low, but, you know, not beyond our reach, I would say.
I see. Okay. Let me turn now to our third speaker, Dr. Stefan Meister, who has been the head of the Robert Bosch Center for Central and Eastern Europe, Russia, and Central Asia at the German Council of Foreign Relations, DGAP, since January of 2017. Congratulations on your new position. It's quite...
Growing up.
Yeah. It's sort of timed simultaneously with the inauguration of the Trump administration, no doubt. Previously...
What the word means.
Stefan... just nothing. Make of it what you will. He was a senior policy fellow at the European Council on Foreign Relations, wider Europe team, and a senior fellow also at DCAP. And his areas of research include Russian domestic foreign and energy policy, EU-Russia relations, Russia's policy toward post-Soviet countries, and he writes widely on Germany's Russia policy, of course. In 2013, he edited a volume on Russia's policy towards the post-Soviet countries with Nomos. He was a visiting fellow at the Transatlantic Academy in Washington and co-authored the book, The Eastern Question, Russia, the West, and Europe's Gray Zone, which I was happy to contribute to one of the chapters to that came out in 2016. So, Stefan, the floor is yours.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank you, Andy, and Angela for inviting me for this event and adding also two European perspectives to the US-Russian discussion we have here. And I more or less presented also the German perspective. And I think this is what I want to do. I want to give you an impression how Germany sees at the moment Russia and the Russian-US relations. And then I will give some recommendations. How to deal Stodielac with Russia. Germany is seen as crucial with regard to Russia, but the German-Russian relations have never been at such a low level since the end of the Cold War. We observe the failure of change to interievement policy. We observe the failure of partnership for modernization, and we observe in the end the deny of the Russian leadership to modernize their country. Europe is no model anymore for this Russian leadership. I think this is very crucial. And modernization seems to be even dangerous for the Putin system. From a German perspective, Russian leadership has not rewarded Germany's role in stopping NATO enlargement towards Ukraine and Georgia. No other Western state has invested so much in post-Soviet Russia and was criticized for his policy of appeasement, and there are many, many other words, but has now become alienated from today's Russian leadership very substantially with the Ukraine crisis, with the annexation of Crimea. I think this is really a fundamental shift we observe at the moment in the German discourse and in the German elites. Talking about US-Russia relations from an EU, in particular German perspective, Berlin realized that we are sitting in the same boat with Moscow at the same time, at the moment. Neither Russian nor German leadership knows what Trump really wants, and both are skeptical in terms of his priorities and unpredictability. Germany is looking for allies in dealing with the new US president, but Russia is no option. Russian leadership has destroyed any trust and made it nearly impossible through its lack of compromise in Ukraine and the disinformation campaign in Europe to have a proactive and cooperative approach towards the Kremlin. We observe that the German main parties decided not to raise the relations with Russia as a main topic for this year federal election campaign. Even the Social Democrats don't raise the topic because it's so sensible at the moment. And I think this turning point has started with the Russian-Syria campaign. Both Putin and Trump do not trust in and undermine international law and institutions. Both believe in deals of great leaders and do not care about the interests of small states. That will bring them into conflict with EU policy. International law and international institutions are at the heart of German foreign policy. Also, as a learning process from the past, for Germany, the European Union is the top priority in its policy. If there is a conflict with Russia or the US, Germany will always choose to support the integrity of the EU for stability and welfare in Europe. A bilateral deal with Germany is not on the table, only with the EU. The big concern about a fast deal between Putin and Trump on Ukraine and European security seems to be gone. Russian leadership misperceived Donald Trump in his first euphoria, but not based on facts, but maybe more on their own narratives and propaganda. There is an understanding that while the US is the number one priority for Moscow, Russia is not a priority for Trump. I think here he stands also in the tradition of his predecessor. While Germany and most of the EU would always have an interest to re-engage with Moscow on a rule-based fundament in terms of security and energy policy, as well as in Europe, as well as in the common neighborhood, Russia is focused mainly on the US to strike a deal. Germany offers platforms and measures on trust building and arms control. We remember the OSCE chairmanship of Germany last year, which was a huge investment of the German government also with regard to Russia. But Russia is mainly focused on striking a deal with the US and mainly focused on US policy. Russian leadership is missing the opportunity to re-engage with Berlin and other EU member states because it believes that with the upcoming European elections and Trump, its bargaining position will improve anyway. Germany would give much to the Kremlin if it would show any small signal of compromise with regard to Ukraine. The longer Putin waits, in my opinion, the more it will be willing to find a common ground. This damage is very substantial, but Russian leadership seems to have no interest to stop its destructive policy. At the same time, the fundament of our bilateral relations is deteriorating. Russia is now on position 16 for German export, behind Poland, Czech Republic, and Hungary, and for imports on position 13 behind Poland and Czech Republic. This is not, first of all, due to sanctions, but to the investment climate in Russia and the role of the state in the economy. Even if Nord Stream 2 will be built, the global energy market is already changing and pipeline gas will play lesser role in future. The change on the German energy market through the Energiewende will lead to less oil and gas demand. The reinvention of the big German energy companies to mixed and mainly electricity companies has also impact on the Russia lobby in Germany. All what is linked with Russia is now securitized in Europe. I think that's a big change. The dominance of politics over the economy will last longer, also if sanctions will be abolished. There is a consensus among the German elites that sanctions should be lifted only if there is progress in eastern Ukraine. I think, therefore, the French election seems to become more important to Germany than the elections of Donald Trump to stand together on the sanctions in Europe. But if there would be an alternative, I think we don't stick to the sanctions. Sanctions are not a goal in itself, but it needs some kind of signal and compromise also from the Russian side. I think the lack of any fundament in the US-Russia relations for a reset or grand bargaining and the failure of the pivot to China should lead to a refocus of Russian leadership to Europe. Instead, Russian leadership feels strong with its success in Syria, Ukraine, and disinformation campaign. I think all this will play back because Russia is lacking any constructive and positive agenda at the moment. These short-term gains cannot be lie over the structural deficit of the current Russian policy. But I don't see the starting point at the moment for progress or the new modus vivendi. We are looking for the starting point, but it's difficult to find it. I think we somehow have to accept that we have different perceptions at the moment of crucial issues. And we need to prepare also for scenarios. It was interesting, we had yesterday at ZEISS a similar discussion, also discussing on what to do in the Western Russian relations. And my impression, and I think I also discussed this with Angela, was that the Russian side is very much focusing on the big question of order, finding a new framework of the relations, while we are focusing on the small steps. Yeah, I think we have to rebuild trust, and that's very difficult. And I don't think that we will find the big topics to do so. But we need to have these small steps. And I think I completely agree. We need to have confidence building measures. We need an update in arms control. We need agreements in cyber and disinformation. We need to reanimate also platforms like NATO-Russia Council. And we need to talk and to find solutions in Ukraine. I think there's a lot of to do. I think the US and the European Union should work there together, also in dealing with Russia. We all have this hope, yeah, that there will be a possibility for a new modus vivendi, but I think the basis has to be rebuilt, the trust has to be rebuilt, and I think that's the most challenging thing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stefan. Indeed, we do have a lot to do. I'm not quite sure how much will there is to do it.
That's the question.
But we will continue. Let me now turn to Dr. Arkady Ostrovsky, our next speaker, who is the Russian Eastern European editor of The Economist. Prior to this role, he was the Moscow bureau chief for The Economist, reporting on the annexation of Crimea, the war in Ukraine, and many other subjects. He joined the paper in March of 2007 after working for 10 years with the Financial Times, where he also covered Russian politics and business, including the Yugos affair. I want to point out that Arkady's terrific, relatively new book, The Invention of Russia, The Journey from Gorbachev's Freedom to Putin's War. Really an excellent book, basically a narrative of the history of post-Soviet Russia, the late Soviet period as well, through the lens of what happens with media and the media business and media's relationship with power. I want to congratulate him. As just 2 days ago, he was awarded the Overseas Press Club of America Best Nonfiction in International Affairs.
Thank you very much.
Not too shabby. Arkady, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Andy, and thank you, Angela, for inviting me for organizing this event. It is a great honor. As for the prize of the book, I must also thank two people in particular who I think made it a great success in or relatively good success in the West. One is Vladimir Putin, and the second one is Donald Trump now, who made it both made it very, very topical. So I'm as a lot of journalists, I'm grateful for keeping us busy.
Putin's good for business.
Yeah, Putin is good for business, and war is good for selling papers. I think it's a great subject, and I imagine that a few years ago, the idea of a conference on 25 years on from the end of the Cold War would have been of great but mostly academic interest, and suddenly I think it's of extreme relevance. And as Dame Judi Dench says, as M in one of the Bond movies, God, I miss the Cold War. and I think this has actually now stopped being a joke and become quite a real thing. I'll try to talk about it, because I think what we're living through is not as some of us tried to write, looking for historical references, a return to the Cold War, but it's the result of the end of the Cold War, or the way in which the end of the Cold War had been perceived both in Russia and in the West. And I think we are slightly out of date looking, if we are just looking at the Russia-US relations and conflict, because I think it is much more, I don't like the word global, but it's a sort of a broader opposition from the one it was in the Cold War, when it was two systems and two ideologies, because we are looking really at the standoff between liberal order and liberalism and nationalism and populism. And those two phenomenons do not no longer confined to any one country. They can be, as we've seen with Brexit, with the rise of populism and nationalism in Europe, Marine Le Pen, thankfully Germany is much more immune, but AfD, Alternative for Deutschland, is also making inroads, and of course the election of President Trump. This phenomenon is now, the frontiers are a lot less clear. And the reason I think that studying the end of the Cold War is so essential is because ultimately it's how the two countries, which represented two systems, had perceived the end of the Cold War that has led us where we are today. In Russia, I'm not going to go through history of Russia, certainly not in this audience, where you know better, much better than I do. Russia has emerged from the end of the Soviet Union without a clear idea status. But with a thought, a sort of premise, that once the communist system was gone, once the Soviet government, the Bolsheviks were gone, Russia would become what became a sort of most important word of the 90s, would become a normal country. It would join the civilized world, it will move towards the West. Russia went through its own, and I not for a second want to address the question of who lost Russia, because I don't think Russia was anybody's to lose apart from its own elites. Just as America is nobody's to lose apart from its own elite, every elite has responsibility for what happens in its own country, although the relationship between the two have shaped what happened inside both of those. The crucial point, as we know, as Secretary Albright rightly focused, zoomed in on, was 99. It was not just the bombing of Belgrade, it was also a year after Russian financial crisis, which drew a line under a lot of efforts to make Russia into market economy, or functioning market economy. It was a disillusionment with the liberals, with the westernizers in the Russian government, with the failure of some of the efforts to deliver on that promise or their expectation at the end of the Soviet Union, that was ultimately sublimated into anti-Americanism. In 1999, I'm not judging whether the action was right or wrong. I'm merely stating what I think for a lot of Russians the turning point was in 1999. And of course, the rhetoric, also as Secretary Albright said, the rhetoric of the Bush senior administration, which declared the victory in the Cold War, and the combination of the words victory and war immediately conjured up in mind the idea of a military triumph, which I think, has played a very cruel joke on America itself, because it enhanced the idea of military power as a tool of foreign policy in spreading democracy. And victories can be also quite a dangerous thing. And Russia, of course, Putin has used that rhetoric, because if Russia was defeated, then it was only natural that one day it would seek a revenge. And that rhetoric paved the way for allowing Putin to exploit all the traumas that were associated with the end of the Soviet Union. Now, it also had another very important consequence, I think, for America and the West, which is why I think we do miss the Cold War. The Cold War did sustain and mobilize the West intellectually and the idea of liberal order. When President Reagan, Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher could be both what one might call sentimental patriots or nationalists, but believed that it was in the best national interests of both of the West to stand for freedom. And Russia was defeated not by the American military power, but by idea of America as a symbol of freedom and supremacy of human life over anything else. It was that model and Gorbachev's aversion to violence and refusal to suppress that notion with force that has basically led to the end of the Soviet Union, when the advantages of America as a model of freedom became just too obvious to anyone, and people did not wish, unlike today, to believe in propaganda. Today we have a situation where, I mean, Putin understood that, you know, we've been writing about Russia for a long time as if it has been a separate issue from the West. We now see Russia in a very different light, as being in many ways a precursor to the processes that are happening in our, you know, in the Western societies. For the second time in the past 100 years, Russia has been a laboratory of ideas, just as it was a magnet for the left in the 1920s and 30s. It's now become a beacon of nationalism and macho nationalism for the right. And some of the comments made by Stephen Bannon and alt-right in America testify to that only too clearly. Now, one thing which Putin understood, not straight away, but pretty early on, was the importance of ideas and narratives over anything else. It was partly that Russia couldn't really become after the oil boom, could not sustain that economic growth, that he came up he brushed up the narrative of imperial nationalism, which manifested itself, culminated in the annexation of Crimea and the war in Ukraine, which was very much staged for television cameras. I think what happened with the liberals, both in Russia, in almost sort of caricature way, and then in the West, is that the liberals have become technocrats. In Russia, we had the governments of Yegor Gaidar, of Anatoly Chubais, who talked about the IMF, who talked about fiscal discipline, monetary measures, which was all very good, but not for a country that was living through a post-imperial syndrome and trauma. In the West, the liberals have turned into technocrats, again started talking about purely economic issues, trade treaties, etc., believing that that's what people wanted. I think the war in Iraq and the beginning of the decline in American productivity at the same time also contributed to the sense of loss and loss of status, loss of direction, and people started looking for narrative and idea. And both Trump and Putin, different as they are, in one respect are very similar, in that both are postmodernist television personalities. Putin began, as you know, as a very low-ranking KGB officer in Dresden, the least prestigious posting, one of the least prestigious postings in the KGB, not even part of the first Directorate of Intelligence Service, but managed to build an image by stripping down and dressing up, as brilliantly described in Fiona Hill and Cliff Gaddy's book, Mr. Putin, Operative in the Kremlin, as Mr. Ban, a character from a British cartoon, managed to basically elevate himself into this idea of an all-powerful, great James Bond spy who can fly planes, who can dive, who can ride, who can do all those things. and use the myth of the KGB as this mysterious and very knowledgeable organization, which certainly existed. President Trump fashioned himself as a self-made great businessman and mogul, although he was a rich kid who misspent other people's money and teetered on the brink of bankruptcy several times. But through television, through Apprentice, he has built himself into a figure nationally of great success and business triumph. So different as they are, they've used the media and the narrative very powerfully, and what's more, they've offered something, a historic narrative which the liberals have given up after the end of the Cold War because they thought it was unnecessary, because they believed that this was the end of history. We gave up, including The Economist, where I'm very proud to serve, we gave up these sort of historic narratives, allowing Putin, the likes of Putin and Trump, to seize that. We should have been more careful students of the writing of those who were responsible for liberal order and democracy in Europe after the Second War. And I would just like to, almost at the end, to quote, I almost know it by heart because I've been citing it nonstop for the past few months, ever since Trump's election. It's a quote from George Orwell, who's not accidentally, whose 1984 has become the top bestseller, both in America this year after Trump's inauguration, and 2 years earlier became the top seller in Russia after Russia's invasion of Ukraine. In 1940, in his review of Mein Kampf, George Orwell wrote, "Hitler has grasped the falsity of the hedonistic attitude to life. Nearly all Western thought since the last war, certainly all progressive thought, has assumed tacitly that human beings desire nothing beyond ease, security, and avoidance of pain. The socialist who finds his children playing with soldiers is usually upset, but he is never able to think of a substitute for the tin soldiers. Tin pacifists somehow won't do. Hitler knows that human beings don't only want comfort, safety, short working hours, hygiene, birth control, and in general, common sense. They also, at least intermittently, want struggle, self-sacrifice, not to mention drums, flags, and loyalty parades. However they may be as economic theories, fascism and Nazism are psychologically far sounder than any hedonistic conception of life. The same is probably true of Stalin's militarized version of socialism." Now, I don't want to stretch the parallels. I'm not for a second suggesting that Putin is Stalin. He is not. That would be disrespectful to millions of Stalin's victims. And not for a second would I suggest that Trump is Hitler. I'm merely talking about the importance of those heroic narratives. We live in the television era where you don't need mass mobilization, you don't need mass wars, as Russia demonstrated only too clearly, both in its annexation and of Crimea and the war in eastern Ukraine, and subsequently in meddling in German politics through disinformation. You can use television, you can use foreign policy as raw material for television cameras and give people that satisfaction. Now, this is all pretty gloomy. I do think that, however, we do have a great silver lining. I think the election in the US has actually achieved, sort of had a sobering effect on Europe. I think the French, just out of the spirit of being controversial and contrary, will now look very carefully at their choice.
You mean being French?
Being French. I think Germany is very aware of it. And I think Russia has become whatever it is that Donald Trump and Michael Flynn and President Putin might have wanted to do. They've actually achieved the opposite. Russia has become a toxic issue. As Stefan says, for the first time in German history, SPD, which was based around the idea of Ostpolitik, doesn't want to discuss Ostpolitik and doesn't want to discuss Russia. Russian ambassador to the US is not a persona non grata, obviously, but is somebody I would imagine any American official would be very, very worried about being seen in public. What's more, I think we've had a big turn. The biggest change is that the left has turned away from Russia, both in Europe and in the US. If Putin supports Trump, that must be something wrong with the idea of the left and Putin. I think that's very important. And on the other hand, the traditional Republican Party, from what I don't want to be presumptuous and talk about US politics, but I think is quite troubled by some of the statements that Trump has been making about Putin, including the one that there are a lot of killers in the world. The result of all this is we now might end up looking from the outside, and maybe this is wishful thinking, but we might end up with a much stronger US team looking at Russia than we've had in the past perhaps 30 or 40 years. The appointments of McMaster, Mattis, the hopeful appointment of Fiona Hill, one of the best analysts of Russia and Putin, actually gives quite a lot of hope. And Rex Tillerson, who, whatever he may do with this knowledge, certainly knows how Russia operates, being in the middle of the UCAS affair as the head of as the right-hand man of Lee Raymond at Axon. So I think it will be. I think the relationship will be a lot less. We're now, you know, we used to worry about the tension between the U.S. We're now worried about the friendship between the grand bargain between the two presidents. I think actually it will be a much tougher relationship, and I think the danger lies in the two falling out and controlling, obviously, two nuclear buttons. I think the key issue will remain, as it has been over the past few years, Ukraine, the conflict in Ukraine, and what we do. And I would leave it at that, but I would like to raise a point that we need to be a lot more honest when we talk about the issue of Ukraine, because the Minsk II agreements are, whatever we call them, in effect, and certainly in the Kremlin's mind, is nothing else but a capitulation agreement by Ukraine and by the West. And nobody would be more interested in implementing those than President Vladimir Putin. And I think we need to be honest and think of reformatting that for the sake of making Ukraine, which is so crucial, as everybody knows, to what happens both in security in Europe and in Russia, a key issue, rather than trying to make the Europeans ourselves feel good about the fact that we impose sanctions, which we know perfectly well have no effect on Putin's behavior whatsoever.
You know, that optimistic note, the good news is that we're in for a much tougher relationship, which
And that Kislyak cannot meet U.S. officials.
But he can't. Well, he's under the table over there.
Yeah.
No, but I
it's a major accomplishment.
It's we may very well be coming to this, because the Trump administration is a very curious combination of some very serious people.
Yes, absolutely.
Secretary of Defense, Secretary of State, National Security Council, and a high degree of chaos and self-inflicted mistakes be made within the White House itself. What side will prevail remains to be seen. Let me turn now to our last speaker, but not least speaker on the panel, not by a long shot, Dr. Paul Duquesnoy, who was professor at the American University of Beirut.
Someday I'm going to teach you how to say my name right, Andy.
Quinoa. We got it?
Yeah.
Duquesnoy.
A plus. Okay.
Duquesnoy. Thank you. And previously at the American University in Cairo. This is kind of a homecoming for Paul, as he did his PhD in history here at Georgetown University under the supervision of the late Richard Stites. So we're always happy to see Paul back here. He is a very astute observer, in particular of Middle East politics, Russia's activities in the Middle East. And he moonlights, or maybe this is moonlights is not quite the right term, but moonlights in business as an investor. So as a varied perspective, I think, on the matter at hand. Paul?
Well, thank you, Andy, for that very full biography. And thank you, Angela, for organizing this wonderful conference here today. And thank you all for staying until the bitter end. I'm happy to be the last panelist because my assessment is the gloomiest of all. So I'm going to send you off into Friday night. Very, very sad. I'm sorry.
I thought it looks like it's alphabetically, but it's actually
it's even getting worse.
if you take out my particule, it's quite correct. It should be last. So
anyway,
Q comes after O. So my response, short answer to this question you asked at the beginning, что делать, is a very not very nice привыкайтесь, or get used to it. Because I'll speak to you as a split personality, first as an historian and then as an investor venture capitalist. As an historian, I want to draw your attention back to Professor Taubman's very insightful summary of the Cold War this morning and observe to you that, in fact, relations have been an awfully lot worse than they are now, that we have had near nuclear war within living memory in the Cuban Missile Crisis, that the early 1980s particularly were not a great time in US-Soviet relations, if you want to make that continuum argument, and that what we have now is not pleasant, a low ebb, quite difficult, but not at all unprecedented in the history of US-Russian relations, again, within the relatively short-term history that we're looking at. And as the only historian on the panel today, it seems to me that this is something that we should simply accept, that nations throughout time have had irreconcilable interests. I'm going to move into what a businessman and venture capitalist would now think of this. And very often, the deal doesn't go through. You cannot reach common ground. It's never a surprise. It's almost to be expected. The state of nature of our species is conflict. Any understanding of US-Russian relations, particularly with relation to the Middle East today, has to embrace that idea. And I don't want to repeat what my fellow panelists have been saying, most of which I agree very much with, so I'm going to limit my commentary largely to the situation in Syria. I'll start by saying that the Arab perspective is, of course, quite different, and in fact, our idea of 2.5 minutes to midnight is when you go out at night in Beirut. Right? So
for dinner.
Well, you might start dinner around 11, and you'd meet your friends at like 2.5 minutes to midnight, and you'd get home at 6 in the morning. But that's how things can change when you cross cultural boundaries. And indeed, if you look at the situation today in Syria, it seems to me very much like that problem is intractable, that neither side has a real interest in solving it or in taking the steps necessary to reach a productive solution. From the Russian point of view, which is what I study academically since I've left Georgetown, it's my sort of new long-term project, I'll say that, and again, if I can make a more general comment, the current Russian international strategy seems to me almost hopelessly unrealistic. I'm sure I'm not going to get the Order of Friendship for saying what I'm about to say, but it is very, very difficult to act as a great power when your economy is smaller than Spain's. And trying to maintain, reestablish and maintain a permanent hegemony over post-Soviet space is a very, very difficult challenge for Russia today. We did actually see that, despite the very bold move in Crimea and eastern Ukraine. Russia's actions were actually quite limited. How was Ukraine taken over? Was it an invasion? No, they infiltrated little green men, announced that they didn't know what they were doing there, and then had their annexation referendum. In the eastern Ukraine, they tend to blame local people for being radical Russian nationalists who don't enjoy the support or unanimous support of the Russian government. Putin boasted that Russian soldiers could take Kiev within 2 weeks if they did a blitzkrieg-style attack on Ukraine. My question was, if he's so powerful, why didn't he do it? Same thing in Syria. Russia's involvement in Syria was largely limited to an air campaign. They don't have what we call boots on the ground. They have their small air base and their naval installation at Ataya, but so what? If you look at general Russian policy in promoting Russia as a rival center of power in the world, it is mainly diplomatic, trying again to draw in people like Marine Le Pen, who is meeting with Putin today in Moscow, supporting the Hungarian far right, which now has a big stake in that country's government, looking at extremists, nationalist extremists in other places as a potential axis of support, and also a cultural diplomacy, arguing that Russia, if not, is not a military superpower anymore, is at least a cultural superpower. How nice. But at the same time, it doesn't solve the fundamental problem that they're seeking much loftier goals than they can possibly achieve. And in the Syrian case particularly, what we see there is an inability to abide by successive agreements, all of these ceasefires, which proved to be very brittle, which are routinely violated by the Russians, you know, with
can I turn to you
impunity, but also in a way that is actually quite designed to cause them to break down. We have these attacks on hospitals, the attacks on the aid convoys that happened the last time I spoke at Georgetown, that had happened, I think, the day before, completely ruining my plan for the talk, but nevertheless creating a fruitful discussion.
Good turnout.
Oh, yeah. How many people RSVP'd for that?
100?
More, I think, yeah. That's pretty good, man. Yeah. But anyhow, this continuing problem where there seems to be no basis for an agreement. Now, from the American perspective, of course, backing away from Syria is also not palatable. President Trump ran a campaign promising to eradicate ISIS, which still controls large parts of the country. He said he'd do it within 30 days, so he's a bit late on that, but I don't think this is something he's willing to give up anytime soon. The only silver lining that we have is these unconfirmed reports of intelligence sharing between the American and Russian military within Syria. The American advisors to the Iraqi army are supposedly sharing information, but our government denies this. The Russian press is saying that this is a very good idea if it were true, but nobody quite wants to admit that degree of cooperation. Any sort of climb down from these flashpoints, if you want to talk about Cold War flashpoints, we can talk now about new Cold War flashpoints, would seriously undermine the authority of both presidential administrations, both the Trump administration and Putin's regime, would suffer mightily if they admitted that they were going to back down. And it seems like the only acceptable solution in Syria for the United States would be a complete Russian withdrawal, and that the only acceptable solution for Russia would be a permanent Russian presence. Obviously, this is not a problem that will be solved while either man is in charge of his country. And in Putin's case, that's probably going to be a lifetime appointment. I think that's fair to say. In Ukraine at the same time, if I can extend my comments northward, it seems like it's the same problem. Trump's already said that Putin would have to return Crimea to Ukraine. Raise your hand if you think that's going to happen. Nobody? Oh, I agree. Yeah. But that nevertheless, without that, there is simply no way forward. There is no avenue of pursuing a rapprochement. I think very cynically, again, I do work in business, that that's partially by design. Russia's approach to foreign policy problems does tend to be highly legalistic, and they understand very well, for example, what the requirements for NATO membership are. And I made this point in my last talk here in September, but in both Georgia and Ukraine, there was a large constituency for NATO membership. One of the NATO rules is that you have to have unquestioned territorial integrity to join the alliance, and with frozen conflicts in eastern Ukraine and also in Abkhazia and Ossetia, guess what? You have a complete disruption of territorial integrity. So even if these populations wanted to join NATO, they wouldn't be allowed to because they don't meet the requirements of the law, right? And I think that's a very cynical move, and that may be very well all Putin wants out of his involvement in those countries as he tries to build a power base, perhaps successfully, to reestablish something like a Russian hegemony over post-Soviet space. Now, the challenges clearly are there. We can debate the importance of the sanctions. It's completely clear that the Russians would very much like to have those sanctions removed. We do not know what was said in all of those conversations. Nobody seems to remember between Jeff Sessions and Michael Flynn and Ambassador Kislyak. Is he behind the curtains, Andy? Until we do know that content, we can only guess. If I had to guess, and Angela and I had talked about this at dinner, I think in December, I would be willing to say that they probably discussed ways to remove the sanctions. Tillerson, as CEO of ExxonMobil, presided over something like very close to $1 billion investment in oil exploration in the Kara Sea, a project that's now frozen because of the sanctions. I would be really surprised if he didn't want to remove that. Well, maybe he's become an idealist, but I doubt it. So there clearly were contacts, and we can surmise, probably guess correctly, that these did have to do with the removal of sanctions. It doesn't look like that's going to happen now. The elite public opinion in the United States militates strongly against that. Many people like John McCain, who's still very vocal about this, would like to make those sanctions, in fact, stronger. So would some of the European countries. So I don't think you're going to see that kind of climb down that would be necessary to strike some kind of grand deal. I don't think we'll have any sunny idealism in the ranks of diplomacy. What I can say is that I do think America and Russia will cooperate in these sort of low-hanging problems that Andrei mentioned, where if there is a point of common interest, we can act on that. And from my point of view, not just cynical, but also historically trained here at Georgetown, it seems to me that it's perfectly reasonable to expect common solutions to emerge from discussions of that type. Even at the height of the Cold War, the United States and the Soviet Union were capable of cutting trade deals. All right, so it's quite possible that we can find common axes of agreement on perhaps minor issues, but issues that are important and may serve as a larger basis for a future understanding. I'm encouraged by this intelligence sharing because Russia does have a problem with radical Islam. The official media tends to ignore this, but it's actually quite bigger than they would like you to believe. So solving that common concern might be in the interests of both countries, and I think that would be, if I had to give the president advice, and I wouldn't want that sort of job, but if I did, I would say pursue that as your major policy goal. It would be universally popular, probably effective, and could lead to a larger understanding, which would otherwise be elusive.
Okay, thank you, Paul. I mean, essentially, there are fundamentally irreconcilable differences, or they're going to remain irreconcilable for a long time to come. But within that framework, as we did during the Cold War, we can find islands of cooperation.
Very small ones.
And maybe some measures to mitigate the existing dangers.
Very minor ones.
Such as more deconfliction. Let me just turn back to maybe to Andrei first, and Paula, as we have kind of gotten quite a bit gloomier as we've gone down
Sorry.
The line here. No. That's not. It's let a thousand flowers bloom. This is what makes things interesting, right? Andrei, what's your perspective on just how irreconcilable the situation is?
Well, you know, history teaches us that nations can compete for resources or for trade routes, for markets. They might have territorial disputes. They might have religious contradictions or ideological contradictions. We don't see anything like that between Russia and the United States. I think that what Trump tries to sell to the US public, and correct me if I'm wrong, then the real challenge for the United States is not Russia. It's another country to the east-south of the Russian borders. And if it is the case, we have to conclude that Russia for the United States, or the United States for Russia, for this matter, is an enemy of convenience. It's cheap, it's affordable to have Russia as enemy for this country. Likewise, it is affordable to have the United States as an arch enemy for the Kremlin. It's much more difficult for Russia would be right now to argue that, you know, China, with its growth, with its potential territorial claims or whatever it is, yellow peril, that is something that represents a real challenge. I think that what we see now, if you put aside, you know, the logic and the dynamics of the current unfortunate developments, it's an artificial situation. There are not too many real clashes of practical interests between our two countries, in my view. Maybe I'm wrong, then correct. Second, you know, speaking of Russia, you know, the discussions that we often have in this city about Russia, or rather you have in this city about Russia, remind me the old Soviet discussions about the United States. On the other hand, it was maintained that the United States was on the trajectory of rapid and steep decline. You know, capitalism is in the crisis, and this crisis is likely to get deeper and deeper. On the other hand, Uncle Sam was so omnipotent that he could influence everything in the world, including every problem that the Soviet Union confronted. From bad harvest, you know, to dissident movement or nationalist movement somewhere in the Baltics. I would venture to say that for this country, it is important to look at the sources of the problems that this country encounters. And I think that the big issue for all of us should be whether we're really entering a new period in the history of the mankind. These ideas of deglobalization and protectionism and the renaissance of hard power, is it something that is likely to last for long? Or is it just a small aberration of history? And maybe already this year will show us that liberalism is back and that, you know, the European Union is on the uprising trajectory. I think this is the big question, because in my view, even if you take a very critical opinion on Putin, definitely he is not the core of the problem, he is a symptom of the problem. At least that would be my idea. And of course, for Russia, it is really important to see how the world is going to evolve. Because if you look at the developments over the last couple of years, if you include Brexit and the elections of Trump and the Middle East implosion, they fit very nicely into the world outlook which dominates the political thinking in Moscow today. Mm-hmm. So if you want to do something with Russia, prove this viewpoint wrong. So far, the jury is still in the session. We don't know. We can only hope.
Hope dies last. Paula, please.
I'll start with the point. I do believe there are irreconcilable differences. And in fact, I think in my opening remarks, I in as much said that. So we sort of circle at the end. Yeah. I actually think, as I heard us go down the line, I don't think there was a difference on that, maybe in the degrees, but each of us in different ways had stated that there were areas that you know, we don't see, certainly during this period and under these circumstances, a coming together and a forward movement. And I mentioned those three reports, not to get myself in trouble, but not to recognize other outstanding work. But I did intentionally, because what was striking to me, actually, starting with the one that has coined the term constrainment, and then mentioning that the end, the Elbe Group, they all are different in terms of the tone, the tenor, their history. But what brings them together is the interest and the activism in trying to identify areas of common ground, however big or however small, depending upon where you're sitting. And they have different outlooks, definitively. But the second point I also think that's important here that has to be taken into account is what I referred to, which to me is very striking, is this issue about attitudes, domestic attitudes. Because with the comments made about sanctions, and I only referenced it briefly, and also about Ukraine, but to me, something that can certainly be said about our legislative branch, they differ on so many things so vigorously, but quite frankly, on this issue, Republicans and Democrats have been strikingly very united in the sense of, one, there's been legislation that says sanctions should not be lifted, and there's already a marker that's been laid down on that very clearly. So to circle back on that point, and with respect to Ukraine, also, markers were laid down in the midst of what was really a very intense and difficult atmosphere. Some of you may recall Congress came forward and supported the issue of arms to Ukraine, the request, which our executive branch opted under the Obama administration, opted not to do. So I just want to factor in attitudes here. We spoke about political will, but I think there are some strongly held attitudes. And finally, you know, on the issue about what are the areas, I think that as part of this, and I think Andre, you know, shared an interesting range and issues that actually, when I was Undersecretary for Global Affairs, many of those issues were issues I was dealing with. I was dealing with climate change and other related type of issues. But I think there's also an element to be injected in this conversation, and that is an element of pragmatism. What do I mean by pragmatism? We have differences in the Arctic, and I hear a lot about the Arctic, particularly from many of the Nordic countries, and what's taking place in terms of a Russian activism, let me put it that way. But I would make the point here, there's also the issue of fundamental search and rescue, and the issue of who has what in terms of capabilities. So I also find, and I'll inject that, it depends on your definition of small. In that context,
very
such,
small.
Such, well, life-threatening situations, and from where you're sitting, that's my only point. There are areas that are of pragmatic concern to all. So, but I do think that it's a changed environment and one in which there are some strongly held differences, and it's difficult to spring from, but the silver lining are all of these various reports and the thinking that's going into it, which to me also conveys a real dedication to try to look at the situation, but also to be thinking creatively and maybe pragmatically.
Yeah, I think there's a certainly consensus. There's no easy way out of this. Let me ask you one quick question, then turn to the audience. So I agree that, of course, that the Trump administration has close to no degrees of freedom for the moment with Russia, it would seem, partly because of the bipartisan consensus in Congress and general anti-Russian mood, but then, of course, the dark cloud of the investigation about possible collusion on the campaign. So Mr. Tillerson, though, is going to Moscow in the first half of April. What do you think is going to be on his agenda? What is on the Russian agenda? What should be on their agenda in this first meeting?
Well, if the question is directed to me.
There you go.
Yeah, I can definitely share my views on that. First of all, I think that Secretary Tillerson comes to Moscow to discuss the first summit meeting between the two presidents. And again, the history of US, Russia and the US-Soviet relations implies that these personal relations are important. I think that realistically, one can imagine a gradual restoration of communication lines, which are unfortunately almost absent right now. I would say that there might be an attempt to discuss a preliminary agenda for the new dialogue. For example, I think that despite all the statements that we heard from the White House recently, the United States is interested in maintaining the two pillars of the U.S.-Russian arms control, namely the INF Treaty and the New START Treaty. And both are under question right now, as we know. So that would be important. I think that definitely we cannot avoid discussing two major regional situations, Ukraine and Syria. And the big issue is whether the United States is interested, whether it is willing to consider both or any of these issues as a priority for the administration's foreign policy. I don't think that we can take it for granted. I can imagine that there'll be an attempt to sell to Russia a tougher US position towards Iran. I think it is something that we can expect. I'm not sure that it will be successful, but I think it's quite imaginable. I think there might be a discussion on international terrorism as well, and maybe we can move as far as to consider some reincarnation of the late U.S.-Russian Intelligence Cooperation Committee, so-called Armitage-Trubnikov Commission, which functioned after 9/11, and I think it functioned pretty well, especially in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. So there are a couple of issues which, in my view, can be considered, if not low-hanging fruits, at least the fruits that we can reach out to. Later on, I think it will depend on whether you can build, or rather, we can build on this success story or not. Frankly, you know, I cannot imagine any major concessions that Moscow would be ready to grant to Donald Trump right away, at least not till the presidential elections of 2018, because the Russian system is stagnant but stable. And I don't think that Putin and his leadership face any immediate challenges that would compel the leadership to make any dramatic changes in its foreign policy or in its relations with the West.
I would add North Korea to that.
That's right. Yeah, North Korea is important.
And can I go next?
Yes.
All right. I think arms control is the obvious one because it's easy, and no strong domestic constituency would oppose arms control. Can you imagine anyone opposing arms control?
Yes.
Well, not that many people, right? The conversation.
The military.
Well, all right, but at least the conversations about it and about non-proliferation, that this is an obvious issue. Again, since Tillerson was the CEO of ExxonMobil, I would be absolutely astonished if they didn't raise the questions of at least some of the sanctions or a partial easing of the sanctions. You don't flush a $1 billion business deal if you can at all avoid it. You don't even flush a $100 million business deal if you can at all avoid it. So I think that's probably pretty likely. From the Russian point of view, what should they seek? Yes, I think it is about removing the sanctions because they are causing damage, including to Russia's budget and including to its military budget, which is set to be reduced within the next 2 to 3 years. There's also domestic rumblings about social services being cut, so this financial strain of the sanctions is having perhaps not a massive effect. It's not going to cause, probably not going to cause a revolution, but certainly an appreciable effect that Putin would probably want to do without. So that would be a very smart question to raise if the American Secretary of State's visiting.
Okay, thank you. Arkady?
Can I start with a previous question about whether the differences are irreconcilable?
Sure.
Because I think we are, again, I think it's really important we move away. We are in the new reality. We had Trump elections, we are having Brexit, and we're talking as if nothing happened, okay? So I think it's...
We are?
Yeah, we are.
I just mentioned
because we're talking about America and then irreconcilable differences with Russia. Now, is the difference, and I would say the difference are not irreconcilable at all. In fact, there is a lot more common ground. On the Putin-Trump side, is there a reconcilable difference between Trump and Putin in the way that President Trump said that the New York Times and the CNN and the media outlets are the enemies of the people, mm-hmm. and in which Putin said the television is lying? Is there really a reconcilable difference between the two when, in his inauguration speech, President Trump doesn't mention the word freedom or democracy, and Russia trumpets it as a great victory of the end of American liberal interventionism? That's on the one side. Now, let me give you a positive one on the other side. Those who came out in the marches in New York and Washington and California, those young people who can compete, who feel confident about themselves and therefore do not need nostalgia, who are not going to buy into the whole idea that we can reconstruct the 1950s America, are they that different from those who came out in Bolotna, in Moscow in 2011 and 12? There is a new generation born in 1991. They've come of age. They're 25 to 30-year-olds now, mm-hmm. who actually have a hell of a lot more in common than we think, and who have exactly the same interests And those interests are, as I said, I mean, they're completely the same. They are in globalization, they are in competition, they are in the liberal order. And so we should stop talking as if Trump does represent the interests. You know, for a long time we've been arguing in the media, in politics, that Vladimir Putin, whatever his support levels, does not represent, that has been the narrative of President Obama, that Vladimir Putin does not act in the best interest of the Russian people, and I agree with that. Does President Trump act in the best interest of all Americans, of those who can, you know, who are active? I'm not sure. Now, in terms of what the two can discuss, and I, by the way, I'm much more, having been reporting on the business sides and having been reporting on the Yukos affair extensively, and being in the room when Mikhail Khodorkovsky got his telephone call in front of Lee Raymond and Rex Tillerson.
So was
that
I.
He is, sorry?
So was I. I chaired the panel.
Yeah. You remember that moment when Lee Raymond walked out. When
some
Khodorkovsky
things you don't
walked
forget,
out
Arkady.
First, having just spoken to Putin about buying a large state in Yukos. Tillerson has not been a pushover. I think whatever he was as a businessman actually does give him a much better understanding of how Russia really works. He was in the room. He knows who Igor Sechin is. He knows who Timchenko and Putin's sort of close circle are. So one thing that Secretary Tillerson will never be able to claim, unlike many others, is ignorance. He knows exactly what's going on and how the Kremlin operates. I would say that the key issue Tillerson and Lavrov should be discussing in preparing the agenda for the two presidents is the issue of Ukraine. Look, for all, as I think Stefan said, and I couldn't agree more, for all the NATO enlargement, we've had Russia first attacking Georgia and then attacking Ukraine. We have, in, you know, 25 years after the end of the Cold War, we have 10,000 people dead in a war in Ukraine on the eastern borders of Ukraine.
Minimum.
Right?
Minimum.
Minimum. 10,000 people have died.
I think it's serious.
Already, more are dying. And the key question we need, and Ukraine is in the danger, perhaps not as great a danger as it was a year ago, but Ukraine is still in the danger of being a failed state and disintegrating. And the key issue that should be addressed is Ukraine, because everything else stems from that. Everything else, you know, Syria, cyber, etc. So, and if it means that we have an opening there, where we say we need security in Europe and we need to draw, and this time it does really need to be a red line, which will protect. And in return for changing the format, for you, President Putin, stepping back from imposing capitulation agreement in Ukraine, and in return for that, yes, Minsk will go, and that means some sanctions will go. Then we should go for it.
Right. I completely agree with that. Ukraine is at the essence of the problem. Yeah. I do not believe that the Russians will raise the sanctions issue because they are fully aware.
Mm-hmm. And Putin loves sanctions.
Putin
likes sanctions.
Whether they love them or not, there are no degrees of freedom right now in this town on sanctions. The sanctions will get worse, harder before they get better. Okay, I've got Paula, then quickly
second.
To Angela. I know we've got five. Oh, you're talking about 5 minutes. I know we're.
Mine is a 30-second because okay. They've already given a lot of points about on
right.
the meeting. But quick ones that I want to mention. It's worth noting Secretary Tillerson just had a meeting with the full Senate Foreign Relations Committee over lunch. And I cannot imagine that Ukraine would not be a very strong recommendation given what I said before, because of thinking about
yes.
the summit and his visit to Moscow, as well as Syria. Those are two issues that definitively I look at the Congress and their engagement. And I just wanted to swing back. I think it is worth noting, because Arkady, your point, I think you were the one who mentioned before the cabinet members. And I think we need to also remind ourselves, it was in full display when they went up, they testified, they've been very outspoken, all of them in different points in time. Bottom line is, they give very strong advice to the president and to this agenda going forward. I think we need to remind ourselves of that fact as well in this. And the president has been listening.
The president does listen. He's listened on at least a couple of things. One, he's been turned on the value of NATO. They do not mess with NATO right now. He's also been turned by Mr. Tillerson on the value of the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. That is a positive sign. Stefan, please.
Just on a short note, I think the main challenge at the moment is between the US and Russia to find a common language and to identify the topics both really find relevant. Because I think that's the shock also in Moscow. If they try to use the topic, or if they try to raise the topics they normally raise with the US and they work, like nuclear, like a new start, arms control, Trump seems to have no idea what is it about, and seems to be not prepared for this. So I think from the Russian perspective, it's at the moment completely unclear what works, what flies in Washington. And I think Tillerson might be the right person to get in contact and to prepare the Trump meeting. But also, I don't know if he can explain what will fly under President Trump in the US. But I think there's really a problem in finding common priorities at the moment. That's my impression.
Yeah, it was remarkable in the first telephone call when Mr. Putin raised the possibility, but we're interested in extending the New START treaty beyond its expiration date in 2021. Mr. Trump went off on some kind of tangent diatribe. Wasn't clear that he was aware of what the treaty was all about, but then he decided it was bad.
Because it was a treaty of Obama.
Yes. I'm afraid that we are really running out of time here. It's about 5 o'clock, and it's been a long day. And I would like to, first of all, thank the panelists here for this discussion. I think it's been quite interesting and illuminating in some ways. And in some ways that maybe the situation is not quite so dark as it may seem. But one lesson I've always told myself with the Soviet Union and Russia over the last nearly 40 years, you know, low expectations, less disappointment. And I think many of my Russian friends feel the same way about the United States. You know, keep low expectations and you're less likely to be disappointed. And there are some fundamentally important things that are just too important for us to ignore. But before I let you all go, I would like to extend some thanks to people who need to be thanked for the conference. First of all, the Carnegie Corporation of New York, I want to acknowledge again, and the several participants here at the conference, Noel Perat, Yevgeny Sherbakov, Pat Nicholas, and Deanna Arsenian. And it was 1 year ago that Angela and I had a gleam in our eye about the idea of this conference, that we should do something. Both of us had written a lot about U.S.-Russia relations and were concerned about the way things were going. Didn't anticipate quite where they would go over the next year. But so the idea was to have a 25th look at the relationship in a 25-year perspective, which would have put us at December and January, right? Well, it was Deanna that said, well, maybe you should do it in March, because then there'll be a new administration and they'll have people in place, and that would be a more propitious time to have the conference. And, you know, well, it was a brilliant idea, not so much because new people are in place, many people aren't in place, but simply because of the topic itself and just how relevant and timely it is. And it was just a couple of days ago that Deanna revealed to me that it was actually Vartan Gregorian whose suggestion it was to hold the conference in March. And if I may paraphrase our president right now about Vartan, I knew that guy. He's a smart guy. Mm-hmm. Now, thank you to Vartan Gregorian and the Carnegie Corporation of New York. They do so much for our field, for trying to do what we can with the U.S.-Russia relationship, and we're very, very grateful for that. The Coca-Cola Company, Clyde Tuggle, and Kathleen Black. Coke has been very active in Russia for decades and has also supported important fora for dialogue like this, and they are also a real friend to the field. Next, all the participants in the conference, both the speakers and the audience, and those that are watching virtually, I mean, thank you very much for your time, your insight, and your interest in this vitally important relationship. It matters a lot. And finally, I want to turn to Georgetown personnel. Firstly, Dean Joel Hellman, who's been very supportive of this in the School of Foreign Service and the work that we do at Ceres. And then within Ceres, of course, itself, I want to acknowledge Associate Director Dr. Ben Loring, who's been very supportive, and a number of graduate students who have helped out, Ava Kim, Kate Baum, Medina Bijanova, April Gordon, Valentino Grabach, and Rebecca Rule. But perhaps most importantly, I want to acknowledge our conference coordinator, Sarah Radomski. Sarah, where are you? Please stand up. This was a pretty big conference, you know, for essentially one person to be coordinating. And Sarah did a wonderful job. And this was her first conference. I can only say, Sarah, I hope that this will not be your last conference because you've done such a tremendous job that none of this would be possible. And finally, I really want to extend my thanks and appreciation to Angela Stent, the co-chair of the conference, a friend and colleague. It's been a real pleasure working together to put this together and other activities, and we look forward to doing more things like this in the future. So thanks so much to everybody for staying with us, and we look forward to continuing the discussion in another place, in another time. Thank you.